Hi, so you can start.
Yeah, sure. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the lab session on vulnerability analysis. And just to recap some of the points that we discussed in our last session. If you remember, I actually showed you the assessment types that are generally conducted, and they can be passive, active, external, internal, host-based, network-based, and application-based. So in previous lectures, we have got some idea on passive and active ways of doing assessments on vulnerabilities. However, we might not have explored more on doing host-based, network-based, and application-based assessments using tools. So as you remember that as part of the solution on assessment, we need to assess people, process, and technologies. So the tools that I'm going to show today are the ones that help us in doing assessments against technology. Okay. So I'm going to actually let you know that only the third step of the whole cycle is actually the one that we are going to discuss today, and a little bit of enumeration is included in it. So why we need to do detailed analysis so that we reduce our scope of activities in exploitation and post-exploitation phases. So I would be discussing Nessus, like three tools. One is called Nessus, another one is Qualys, and there is a free version which comes by default in Kali of a tool called Nikto. So I'll just show you some of the notes that I have, the points which I would be discussing regarding the tools. So as you can see, we would be discussing these 17, 18 points that are there, and a little bit of details on how to basically install and configure the tool along with it. So basically you need to go on Nessus website and register for their trial version of the tool, which is valid for only 7 days. And what you would be getting, once you receive an email, you would get access to Tenable's login platform. And you would, if you click on, go to their download section, you would see, binaries for almost most of the target operating system. So the one that I chose, because I am using Kali Linux, so I use this Nessus 8.13.1. And because my local machine is a 64-bit machine, so I've downloaded this Debian file. And then using the D package utility, which is present, so I installed it. Okay. So I'll show you the command. Okay, and the name of the file, okay, wherever it is stored. This would help you in installing the Nessus version. The point that you need to keep in mind after downloading this file is that it's best to perform a checksum validation, which is like I performed a SHA-256 checksum validation on this, so that it gives you confidence that the file that you have downloaded is not modified in between while you are downloading it. If there is some kind of a mismatch in the checksum you find, then you need to probably download it again. So assume that you have downloaded the file and you have used a dpkg utility to install it on your machine. Okay. Or if there is any other, let's say RPM file you download, then, or any other file that you download, then you have to follow those steps. So once you've installed, ensure that that particular service is related to Nessus is running on your machine. So if you are using Kali or Debian-based Linux, then you can check it with the system control command. Oh, wait, I made a spelling mistake here. So as you see that after installing, you would probably face this, that a particular service is inactive. So you can actually make it active by saying sudo syscontrol, system control start and ssd.service. So once you start it, you can again check the status. So then you would see that it would list various details that under which process ID it is running, how much memory it consumes. Okay, and under which what other queries you can issue against it. But the thing that you would probably not know here is that how you would access the tool. Okay, it's a service that is running, and it's a web-based tool, and you have to know that on which particular port it is running on the local machine. So for figuring that out, I'll just clear this screen. Okay, for figuring that out, you can use the netstat command. Use these flags, ANTP, I mean these options, and then grep. Okay, so you would see that it is actually running on all the services, listening on all the interfaces that are present on my machine, and it is listening on 8834. Okay, so to access it, you would have to go in the browser and use HTTPS. Okay. Double 8834. So if it is for the first time that you are starting Nessus, then you would see that the progress bar of compiling these plugins will be in the beginning. Okay. So as I can see that it is taking a little bit time to restart itself and compiling for compiling the plugins. So let's wait for that.
Hi sir, actually the plugins will take a lot of time actually, approx 30 minutes I think.
No, for me, based on the network conditions, for me it took approximately an hour or so on, and sometimes it happens that if the network connection breaks down in between, then you would have to probably repeat the process. Okay, right now it's already compiled because I already ran some test scans earlier. Okay, and if you're starting it for the first time, you will have to define the username and password. It will ask you to enter a username and a password. Okay. So once you log in the tool, okay, you would see various options. So earlier, when I did not have any folders, this particular screen was blank. It was like this. Okay. So there is a link that I get to create a new scan. Then there is a button with which I can create folders and organize information. And then there is a button with the plus icon also that I can use to create a new scan. Okay, so I'll just go ahead and create a new scan. So once I click on this, you can see that these scans are actually categorized as discovery. Okay, wherein only one scan is there, which is to simply discover live hosts and open ports on the target network. Then under vulnerabilities, you have basic network scan, advanced scan. Then you can scan for malwares, see on Windows and Unix systems. Then for some of these scans, you might have to upgrade to a different version or their premium version, which let you scan mobile devices. You can perform web application tests. So to basically enumerate a lot of information from web servers or any other services that are, which are being run as web applications. So you can also authenticate if you have like user ID and passwords, okay, of the machines, for especially for internal networks, then you can actually do a credentialed patch audit also. You can ask Nessus to log in into those services and scan internally on those machines. And you can do bad log detection. So similarly, you can perform like various type of scans. Okay. So even if, because of some of the other advisories which have been issued by various organizations, time and again, then those plugins also get published as part of, and those plugins are created as part of this framework. And they are also available as part, as scans. So for compliance also, you can see that you can do various scans. As part of this session, we'll do quite a limited number. So we'll take an example on host discovery, and we'll do basic network scan. Okay. And we'll perform one web application test. So let's do a host discovery. Okay, let me just put one host alive. Okay, and before we conduct a scan, let's discuss about something about policies. So let's say you want to create your custom template. Okay, you can define a new policy. You can choose an existing, any of the listed existing scan, let's say basic network scan. Okay. And then for various, like for discovery and assessment settings, you can define a lot of custom values. So you can, under discovery, if you go, you can choose scan types, whether you want to perform a TCP or an RIP or all of the ping hole, scan types, or which of the ports, port scanner settings you can define. You can select all ports, or you can basically all like 65,535 ports, and it would actually use netstat also if some credentials are provided. Okay, then you can actually define a custom scan type also, wherein you can give values for host discovery. You can choose which ping methods you want, so based on like whatever information you have enumerated earlier, fingerprinted on the host earlier. Then you can define the scanning types. Okay. So enumerations, like if you are actually wanting to scan Windows-based host, you can use WMI. If it is like Linux, SSH, and then you can choose whether you want to perform an SNMP or maybe only SYN. And you want to perform a UDP also. So all of these scan types that we have earlier discussed, these options are given for you to configure with the help of defining new policy settings. Okay. Then you can define plugin rules. On the left hand side, I have clicked on plugin rules, and you can create plugin rules. So if you want to hide these, this result on severity in your report, you can say that also. And also you can select the severity level that of a particular plugin. So, but how would you know that which particular plugin you are going to use? So actually these plugins are listed while you are doing the scan, and you have, while you are defining these policies, you will be able to see that what all plugins are there. So let's say I went into a particular policy, selected a basic, just a second. It's taking a little time to load. Okay, let's say you went onto a basic network scan, then under that you would see that what all plugins are there, their IDs are there, and you can actually define those rules for particular IDs, as I showed to you. I think it's facing some problem. Let me check. And let me just refresh it. So it has again gone to that compiling plugin stage. Just a second. We can probably wait a little for it to come back. Okay, so under the plugins tab, you can actually see, say for doing a basic network scans, what all plugins are there. Okay, you can note down the IDs from here and modify or configure or customize things related to these plugins in plugin rules. Okay, so you can see for basic network scans, so many plugins are there. Okay, they will be automatically picked up during scans. It saves a lot of manual work, okay? And you can actually save these things for immediate use later. So let's do a scan. We'll start with a basic host scan. So the host that I was trying as a target, it is taking a little time, and just 1 more minute, and it will boot, and then we'll give the IP, and then we'll continue with the scan. But there are some previous scans that for the time being you can see. Okay, that if let's say, I actually, in my while doing a discovery scan, I gave all 256 hosts on scanme.nmap.org, domain. Okay. Then it started listing all of the IPs, as you can see, which it was trying to discover whether they are live or not. And actually, while doing that, it figured out the vulnerabilities that it looked for. So you can say that on a remote host, which is considered dead, and it was not scanning. Okay, let's do that. So the host that I was waiting for is up. Okay, so we go to new scan and then select a template called host discovery. We need to name it. Anything you can name and give a description. And within the target, you can specify the IP or the host name that I actually showed you. And you can use the CIDR notation also based on the like how big the subnet is or the network is, or how it has been defined. So once you have entered these details, we need to save it. And as soon as you save it, you will see a small launch icon, which looks like a play icon. And you can click on that. So the scan would start. And the small green color spinner you would see under this column of last modified. So while a particular scan is running, it will show that spinner. And when it is complete, it will show the status as completed with a small tick mark. Then you can actually select it. Okay. So in this particular scan, it has not discovered it. Why? Because maybe I'll have to probably reload the, the plugins or recompile them. But we can just check whether that particular, okay, I know I'm not connected to that VPN. Okay. So this is one of the reasons that it might show, zero results. So let's do that again. And while it is running the scan, at that time also you can actually click on the tab. So you can see that it has actually discovered that one host is live, and it has started listing the discoveries, vulnerabilities also. So currently it has taken the time from my local machine. As you can see at the top, it is like 8:56 a.m. and it took actually less than, minute. So as soon as it is over, that you would see the status as completed and the scan information is listed here. Okay. And so this is just to check whether a particular host is live or not. Similarly, let's do another scan. So we'll go to a discovery scan, might not give you much of information on vulnerabilities. So, but let's do a basic network scan against the same host. I give the name, and then again I'll give the IP. I'll save it. Go to the folder on the left hand side, and then click on that play icon. So we might have to wait for a few, seconds or minutes for it to complete that basic net scan. So remember that as many scans you do, you would also have access to the history of it. I actually clicked on this Canvan discovery to show in a basic net scan. Okay. So let it run that basic network scan. And this is for the first time that we have launched this scan. So it has discovered the host already. It has listed with the help of Nessus SIN scanner vulnerability, it has listed down the information. So it shows that port 22 TCP, on TCP is open. Then you can see port 80 is open. And then there is a little unknown kind of a port, I think, 6667. So as soon as you see that a port 80 is open, it means an application or a service is listening on it. It should raise you, some kind of info to you saying that okay, some kind of a web service or web application is there on this machine. So it is still running. And you can see that it is, I think, only completed 4% or something. Okay, I'll just show you a net scan which was done earlier to let you know the results. See, it was against a different host that I performed it. So meanwhile, when it is running against that host, let's discuss about this here. So on the various levels of severity, you can see that the vulnerabilities are showed here. So if you go to a medium level vulnerability, I discussed CVSS scores that are given, and based on the impact and severity is defined for a vulnerability. Okay. So let's say we go to, this severity level called mixed. You can see that it has actually listed vulnerabilities related to SSH weak algorithms, okay, and other related names. So on TCP, on port 22, where TCP is there, SSH service is there, about which it has given a very nice description as to what this vulnerability is about. Now, in that particular analysis, before going on to the next step of exploiting it, you would have detailed information. You would also have risk information, the base score and the vectors. Let's see if it has, that particular scan is still running. Okay. So again, you can see similar results. Okay, you can see CBC mode ciphers enabled, MAC algorithms are enabled, which have low severity. Then you can see, how these scans have been categorized. Okay. So if a particular scan was performed for web servers, you can check this also. So some of the methods that are allowed for web servers, and it sees that they should not be allowed on, okay, on this. Then the server type and version, you can see that it is actually Ubuntu, okay. Apache on Ubuntu. Apache's version is 2.4.7. So this way you can collect as much as information and you can analyze the vulnerabilities. And with the CVE details that I showed you can actually see when what all other information is available on the internet about it. You can go to CVE details or other websites like NSA's advisory website that I showed you yesterday, NVD's database, and you can read more about it. Okay, for the time being, I'll just stop this particular scan and we will move on to another scan type called web application test. So how would you do that if you can actually pause a particular scan or you can stop it. So I'll just click on this little stop button. As soon as I get a pop-up, I'll stop it. And then you can see that, okay. So it has given a cross circle saying that this particular scan was canceled. For a web application, because on port 80, we found that Apache is running. So most probably a web application is there. And then we remember that 6667 some service is running. But let's see what information we could have about that. I'll give the same IP. So I've left all other values as default, okay, whatever is available in the tool. And you can see that it is there under this folder, CEH class, and I'm again launching it. So when a particular scan runs, it would, in this particular table, it will come at the top of the result, I mean, this information. So there is one more option that I heard of under the resources tab, which is called scanners. Okay, what scanners actually mean is that if you have like multiple installations and you want them to work together and compile, not only one host is being used to scan the targets, you could have multiple installations of Nessus on various hosts, and you can actually schedule these scans also. If you find that the machine on which Nessus is installed and that machine is always on, maybe a server running in cloud, and then you can install Nessus on that. And continuously you can scan the targets. So basically, I couldn't find this option here, maybe because it is an evaluation version. But if you want to combine results from various Nmap installations and they are distributed, then that also can be done in Nessus. If you want to schedule a scan, so let's say I'm defining a new scan. Then while defining the basic settings, I can enable the scheduling and I can define the frequency and also with the time zone as well as that when should it start with what frequency. Like I want to scan a target once daily or weekly, you know. So why this kind of a scheduling is needed? Because you never know at what point of time a particular vulnerability will pop up. And it needs attention for you to exploit it, to be exploited. And you never know that when it comes to the notice of the owner of a system, that particular vulnerability might not be there anymore. Okay, so if you don't want to miss on that, then probably you can use a schedule settings as they are shown on the screen. So for now, I'll just disable it. You can also set notifications. You can define the SMTP server and you can say once a particular scan is complete, the result of the scan or some kind of a notification needs to be sent. So while defining the SMTP server settings, you can give these values. So there is one example on, giving these values for the free SMTP server, which is available for you. Is of Gmail, you know, so you can define SMTP server. You can use the authentication as yes. Say that this connection is going to be secure. Then you need to give the Gmail account and password. Okay. While you say that I would actually log in, the auth method as login, then you can give your username and password. And for encryption, you can force the TLS. But Gmail might not allow you, or Google might not allow you to directly log in from an external application. So for that, you would have to go into your settings and then allow that this application there. Some additional step from the Google's end is needed for it to basically send emails on your behalf from that SMTP server. So let's see if that previous scan we started is, you know, is it listing some info or not? Okay, I think it's taking a little bit of time. Okay, so. Okay, can you see, like, let me just see, while doing a web application test on port 6667, it has listed the information about something called IRC. It stands for Internet Relay Chat. So there is some chat server on this particular port, which is running here. Okay. So you can read about this Internet Relay Chat, okay? Maybe you can use an IRC client and then anonymously connect to some kind of a node and see what communication is going on. And you can connect to this server to basically bring out more information in analysis phase. Okay, it's taking a little bit time, so I'll just go back to the previous scans that I did, and I'll just show it to you that how the vulnerabilities were listed. So it discovered actually 12 vulnerabilities last time when I did a scan. So you can see that it says that the application which is installed on the server is vulnerable to clickjacking. So what clickjacking is, and it actually suggests the solution also that, a request, an application should not allow, external domains to initiate iframe applications on a particular page. So you can, and it has also listed down some of the links for you to go through and understand that what click jacking is. So it's basically hijacking the clicks of a user. Say a user wants to click at one particular point, element on a web page, but because of this, a user might end up clicking some other link on a page. So that is called like hijacking a click. So that vulnerability it has highlighted. So similarly, there are some other multiple issues regarding the credentials. Okay. That a particular page allows a user to log in and then it does not go to a different page. The destination page is the same. So this way, if a developer has developed an application, it has some kind of a risk because it can transmit this information to a remote web server in clear text. So it has suggested a solution also. So while as part of Red Teams or as CH, you are performing these kind of scans, then these kind of solutions can become part of your reports. And you can suggest the developers to apply these solutions in the next release of the application. Or maybe if someone has been already affected by this vulnerability, then a patch can be issued to that particular user. Then on directory enumeration, you can see that it says that there are folders like config, docs, external and icons. Okay, then once you have this kind of information on the layout of a web application on the remote server, you could probably use tools like DIR search or Dirtbuster to further enumerate as to what else is there. Okay. Then it has highlighted scans related to CGI abusers. So we have discussed like three types of scans, okay? And basic host discovery and network scan and web application test as with respect to Nessus. So similarly, in case of Qualys also, if you go to their website, you can register for an evaluation version and then they send you a link to log in and you can set your password and all. And then once you log in, you would get this kind of a, UI. So with respect to Nessus, if you want to compare it, you would get a user interface, which is more, inclined towards testing web applications. It might, settings which are related to discovery separately, vulnerability separately, as it was there, which was a response, which was given in case of Nessus. So let's say you go and log in into Qualys, and the prerequisite is to that you have to define a resource, an asset, which is called a web application. So you can see that it looks like this, and you can either create an asset from blank. Or you can choose an existing asset. So let me click on blank. And I'll give this a name. So right now I do not have any appliance that needs to be registered or someone needs to enable for me to scan internal hosts on my network. So I'm giving a public URL, a URL which is publicly accessible for Qualys to go and scan this particular target. So in my previous classes, we mentioned something on Slack HQ that there is a WordPress web server running there. I mean, WordPress application is running there. So then I can give some kind of, crawl scope to it that I wanted to basically limit this scans below the host name, or I wanted to, enumerate the subdirectories, or maybe some other, subdomains. Then I can define that particular scope here. So as of now, I'll just leave it as default. Click on continue. And then I can choose a profile here. So let's say WAS options, all default initial WAS options, and the appliance is external. Okay. And I'm clicking on continue. So if you want to include scripts of a tool which is used to automate web applications, which is called Selenium, then you can include those scripts also here. If there are some links that are redundant and you don't want it to go and crawl those links, then you can actually define them with the help of a regular expression, or you can basically mention them in whole text by keeping them on different lines. Also, additionally, you can define some fuzzing rules. If a particular application requires you to authenticate, then you can create that information from here. And if it is already defined, then you can select that record here. Say a particular application requires you to authenticate, do basic authentication or a server authentication or an NTLM based authentication, then you can, as a previous step to this step, you can create them and select that here. So you can actually add exclusions. Okay, anything that you wanted to not include in the scan or a crawl that it is mentioning. So any default DNS overrides that you want, that you can define here. So if you want to enable any malware monitoring on this web application, then you can enable it with the help of this checkbox. So any further comments related to this particular application, you can define it here. So let's say all the information is given for a web application. Then you can choose either finish and do a separate scan, or you can click on finish and scan. And you can actually click scan it for vulnerability. So it would allow you to define furthermore values for that vulnerability scan. You can name this scan as it has by default taken a format with the application name and the date. Then from the dropdown, you can select the web application that you just defined in the previous step. Oh, it's already selected, sorry. So any user authentications can be given here. But for this application, we don't require. And then if some email notifications are sent, you can check on this box. I mean, if you want to send those notifications, you can select this box on scan completion, and the from address would have this. So as of now, I'm unselecting it. So then when you can review whether the information that you gave was correct or not, and then you can click finish. So then once it has been submitted, then you can go back to the dashboard and see the status that a particular scan against a web application, external web application, has been submitted. So there is one more, that when it is in progress, then you would see a different status change here. And once a particular scan has finished, the status would be given here as finished. And it will actually keep collating the results based on these. Again, I think they have defined it based on CVSS scores. So if some vulnerability is of high severity, then their numbers would be listed here. And if you actually enabled malware monitoring also, then that malware numbers will be listed here with their separate severity levels as high, medium, and low. So as you can see, the status has changed for this particular scan as running. So there is additional further enumeration from my last Nessus scan on the same target. Then I was able to list some of the directories, okay, such as these, okay, that on a particular IP, let's check that manually once, okay. So what I'll do is, like, I'll go to 10 that same IP, because you saw that, you know, a web application is there. So I found that it actually has this page, and it is asking, it has some kind of a message. And if I hover on this link, then it is asking me to go to this URL to test it. So which has like JABC. So if something is running on this server, which is other than the technology scans that we have done with the help of tools, this is something additional that you could further do manually while the scans are running. Let's see if it gives something. So as soon as this page loads, I would like to have a look at the page source. Okay. Yeah, see, you can see that there is some kind of a change in the title of the application. So maybe I can right click and look at, this on the context menu. I can see that view page source is enabled, so I can click on that and see what it has basically in the source code. Again, this can be done as part of next step while doing detailed enumeration, but some part of enumeration we can do, like, while analyzing itself, something that is readily available for us. Okay. Yeah, see, this view source page has loaded. And if I scroll down, I can see that it has some, some just another BioWare company. And I can see that Drupal framework has been used, to create it. Then I can see that it has layout, it is listing icons under miscellaneous. Then there are folders like modules and others. Then there's something called sites. Then also, other than this, then oh yeah, see, there's a node on which home link is there. It's not visible on the page, okay, but it's there in the source. Okay. So what else do we have here? I can see there are some links. So maybe some kind of a menu is there, like about page and jabs and documentation on different nodes with these query parameters and values, right? So probably while I'm looking at this information, I can make note of these links and separately further enumerate it, start enumerating and analyzing them because it is readily available. And also on Google, I can go and do a search about a particular vulnerability, right? Yeah, I can say JABC Drupal 7. Okay. So maybe I can find something. Yeah, see, I can see some walkthroughs are there available. Some people have actually listed some information. There are some articles. So this way you can do additional further information collection and analyze. So let's see if. Okay, this particular scan, a vulnerability scan, is still running. So meanwhile, we'll start covering some commands from Nikto. Okay. So if you in Kali, if you go to the menu, and if you search for that, yeah, it's there. Okay, because I recently used it, it is under recently used. So I can either click on this. And if it is not present in the application menus, then you can, with the help of apt, the package manager in Kali, you can do a search. Okay, by the way, Nikto means no one in Russian. So, right now it's installed. As I can see, the moment I do a search on it, it's installed. And if say it was not installed, then I could actually do Nikto. And it will install it for me. Okay. Because it's currently it's the newest version, so and it further has given me information on what other packages which were automatically installed are not no longer required are also listed here. Let me clear the screen and take some examples. So if you want to have a very detailed help. I look at a very detailed help, then you can use capital H and it will give you the help. So, the options that you see with the plus symbol mean that while specifying these options on the screen, you have to give some additional value. Say while giving CGI DIRS, you need to give these values. Okay. So while giving a display option, you need to specify these options. Okay. So when it is again, Nikto is again like a similar scanning tools for web app. You can do scanning for web applications. Okay. And do further analysis based on whatever it brings you as a result. So it might actually, based on the version that you are using, it might give you information based on vulnerabilities from OSVD, like open source vulnerability database, which is no more there and it's not being maintained. But there is a small tool which can help you further map it with the CVE database. Okay. So that tool is this one. There's a reference map between open source vulnerability database and the CVE database, as you can see. So you can actually go and look for that particular, OSVD number, and against that there's a CVE number, and you can click on link and it will take you to the more detailed information about it. Okay. So this is related to some cross-site scripting, multiple cross-site scripting vulnerabilities in some application called Livezilla. Okay. Then while you can actually define a format, and you can give the name of the format as to under which format you want the results to be saved in. So you can actually combine both Nessus as well as Nikto results together. Let's say you are separately scanning with the help of Nikto and you store the results in a Nessus format, then you can import those into Nessus. And create these results in XML format, and then probably as part of Metasploit framework, you can import those, okay? So you can combine various tools to do and make your results more valuable. Then let me just show you the man page. So any new tool, maybe there is a manual with it. So you can use man Nikto. And as you can see that it is there to scan vulnerability, known vulnerabilities, on web servers. If you want to read more about it, what is libwhisker and all, then please try. And it is based on Perl. Then various options. So while it is doing a scan, you can see whether it is getting some redirects or not, some cookies that it is receiving, what kind of responses on particular URLs are being faced, the HTTP code response codes, right? And if you wanted to list that, you can do it in verbose mode. Okay. Then some of the evasion techniques. It has some evasion techniques from IDSS. Okay, if you want to use them, one or multiple, then you can specify them as part of the command that you give on the command line. Then various formats, but along with the format, you have to specify the file name also, okay? Then you can specify some host with the tag host option, and it can be the IP address or the host name, or it can be the list of host names in a text file. And it can also parse an OG style output, the grepable output from nmap. Now, by default, it uses all these mutations, okay? So what is a mutation? Like it's a technique for it to combine various tests. Okay, and it tries to guess these values. So if you wanted to test all the files with root directories, you can specify that as one. It can also guess the password file names, and it could enumerate the usernames via Apache or CGI wrap. Then different options, different values for mutate is given. And it can attempt to guess these directory names from a dictionary file that you specify on the command line. Okay. You can see that all scanning tools are doing similar kind of information collection from a web server. Then if you want to list the plugins, that what all plugins, by default it uses all the plugins, but if there is some specific plugin that you want to use with Nikto and you don't know the name of the plugin, then you can actually use this list plugins command. List plugins option with Nikto command. Okay, so then you can have a look at what all plugins it uses. So from here you can get a specific plugin name, like after the colon, then name is there. Okay, and then specify that while using this plugins option. Then if you wanted to limit it scan to a limited number of ports, then using the tag port you can use it. So you might be able to understand the difference as to like when you're using a freeware, an open source or something by default which is coming in Kali, against a tool which is commercial. So there you don't have to specify and give a lot of information. Okay, so it depends on your comfort level and obviously on the team as to like how comfortable are they and which particular tool is there in the tool set on which people can collaborate better. So but yeah, there are some interchangeable formats and there's some common formats with the help of which you can exchange the reports between team members and between the tools. So various tuning options that I'm highlighting here. So if you wanted to figure out vulnerabilities related to file upload, some logs, then you can specify those values with a tuning option. Okay. Maybe you wanted to specifically look for vulnerabilities which are related to denial of service. Okay. And it does that, it attacks in that way. It scans it in that way. So it is actually simulating those attack as an external user. It would do that. Okay. Though they are called tests, and if these kind of tests are actually making an application not respond in a particular manner, then it needs to be informed before you conduct these kind of tests in your organization. And you can use proxies with the use proxy option. And you can specify the host header also, which needs to be sent to the target. Maybe you want to craft the request headers before sending them to the application. Then you can specify with the help of vhost option. So various places where it stores configurations are also given. Let's see if our previous scan from Qualys is complete or not. Yeah, it shows it as finished. And you can see that it hasn't actually, on Slack HQ, it hasn't been able to discover any vulnerability of these levels. And we did not check malware detection option. So this result is zero. Various report options that are there. And you can define configurations. So in the free version, these are the two option profiles. And you can define the new profile again, similar to the options that are given in other tool. So my point is that it is always required of you to be always ready to learn a particular tool. So as I highlighted in one of my slides, that all of the tools they have, or the solution that I would say, it usually has these characteristics. Okay. So all of the tools that we have discussed right now, they actually have these attributes. They should be able to help you in getting the inventory on protocols. They should be able to identify the services which are behind the ports. They should be able to check and validate the vulnerability for you, a limited validation. But there might be times when you have to actually go and manually validate vulnerabilities. And all of these tools, like the plugins, and they have this their own signature database, they should be regularly updated. And it should be able to support different network and host types. So as you can see, we gave the IP also, we did a web application test also. There are some different type of scans which can help you further do audits and various other scan types. Then it should be able to some extent, it should be able to imitate the outside attack also. And Nikto is a tool which can actually help you in doing that. So while designing a solution, please do not limit yourself to only one tool. You should be comfortable in using multiple tools. And in some or the other way, you should be able to combine this information into a format which is actionable, with on the basis of which the teams can take remedies, like they can mitigate further, any future attacks which might happen because of the vulnerability analysis that you have done. And if you're part of basically red team, then you might not have to delve this information straightway to the blue teams or to the purple team. So during that time, you should keep this particular report and information very, very confidential so that it does not fall into the wrong hands. So that is for today. If there are some questions, you can ask me. Hello, Vikas, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. So Manas Garge is asking something which is not in our purview. Probably he can file a report and submit it to the local police station. Okay. IPv4 is Internet Protocol version 4. Okay, wherein you use 32 bits to define the address or identity that is given to a device or a node on a network. And then there is a, you can define the identity of a particular machine in a different format, which is version 6. The point you have to note here is that all of the tools that you use might not be well conversant with IPv6 formats. So if you want to analyze, vulnerabilities or, enumerate devices which have only IPv6, in a network, then you will have to probably track them on a with the help of logs or community forums or additional resources. I hope that the query is resolved, Rahul.
Okay, so this is it for today's session. Now they can leave the class. Have a good day ahead. Bye bye.
Okay, bye. Bye, everyone.